On our YouTube channel, you'll find a limited selection of pathology and patient videos. With Osmosis Prime, you'll get access to over 700 videos, including complete coverage of pathology and physiology, and a growing collection of pharmacology and clinical reasoning topics. Try it free today! Everyone who's ever had a pimple has had an abscess. Even though they're tiny, they're still abscesses. An abscess forms when normal tissue, like the gingiva or gums and teeth, for example, is split apart and that new space is invaded by nearby pathogens, like bacteria. In a healthy mouth, normal or commensal bacteria thrive, but don't cause disease. However, any cut or break in the mucosa is an invitation for bacteria to dive in and multiply, causing an infection. When that happens, the immune system typically responds and a battle ensues, with the result being pus, a mixture of bacteria, immune cells, and dead tissue. So, in response to an injury, cells release small chemicals called cytokines, like tumor necrosis factor, interleukin-1, interleukin-6, interleukin-8, and interleukin-17. And these attract nearby immune cells. It's kind of like yelling for help and being heard by the nearby police. In addition, the cytokines also dilate nearby capillaries and make them leaky, which brings more blood to the site, and allows immune cells that do show up to easily slip out of the blood and into the tissue. The first immune cells at the scene are neutrophils, and they release chemicals and enzymes that kill themselves and the bacteria they swallow up, creating a pool of dead bacteria in cells. This is a specific type of acute inflammatory response called suppurative inflammation, which simply means that pus is created in the process. From a macroscopic view, this is sometimes referred to as a liquefactive necrosis, because the area of dead tissue turns to liquid. Initially, the dead tissue is intermixed with healthy tissue, but over time it can coalesce into a single area. And around this pool of pus, a wall of fibrinogen starts to harden into a barrier. Occasionally, sheets of fibrin form septations, creating loculations or pockets of pus within the abscess itself, kind of like an abscess within an abscess. Even though the pus is largely dead material, there are still plenty of live bacteria within the pus, which makes it highly infectious if it gets spread from one place to another. Now, there are a few different types of dental abscesses. The first one is called a periapical abscess, and it's found at the apical foramen of the tooth. A periapical abscess starts when bacteria gains entry into the dental pulp of the tooth through an opening caused by dental caries or from trauma. The inflammation then spreads and causes necrosis or tissue death throughout the entire length of the dental pulp. And if it goes on without treatment, like a root canal, then the infection ultimately reaches the apical foramen of the tooth. Subsequently, the infection reaches the periapical tissues and at that point it's considered apical periodontitis, which is inflammation of the periapical tissues which secure the tooth in its socket. The infection usually develops into an abscess as the pus coalesces, and it can involve nearby structures like the alveolar bone and adjacent teeth. Sometimes periapical abscesses become quiescent, meaning that they don't grow much, but the bacteria remain alive within the abscess cavity. In that situation, it's called chronic inflammation, and it's where a periapical granuloma forms from this walled-off area. In fact, technically, the term granuloma is a misnomer in this case, since these lesions don't look like normal granulomas under a microscope. During this stage, where there's a stalemate between the infection and the immune system, if the infection gains the upper hand, then it's called an acute apical abscess. Another type of dental abscess is a periodontal abscess, and that involves both the periodontal structures and the gingiva. Typically, a periodontal abscess happens when there's a pre-existing periodontal pocket, perhaps from a deep plaque collection or from a medical procedure. Bacteria get into the periodontal pocket and multiply, leading to an infection and an abscess. Next, there's the gingival abscess, which is where the abscess only involves the gingiva next to the bone, called the marginal or inner dental gingiva, while sparing the periodontal structures. This usually happens when food, plaque, or another foreign object gets stuck in the gingival sulcus, providing a protected place for bacterial growth. Finally, there's a pericoronal abscess, and this happens when the tooth does not erupt completely, leaving a flap of gingival tissue over the top of the crown. When food or another foreign object gets deeply trapped between the flap of gingival tissue and the top of the tooth, an abscess can form. Generally speaking, dental abscesses contain a mix of different bacteria. Some are facultative anaerobes, which means that the bacteria prefer to make energy using oxygen, but can also survive without oxygen, like the Streptococcus anginosus group and the Viridans group of streptococci. Others are obligate anaerobes, which means that the bacteria thrive only in the absence of oxygen, like Fusobacterium and Prevotella groups. Symptoms of dental abscesses mainly include local pain and swelling, as well as generalized symptoms like fever and malaise. Dental abscesses can cause affected teeth to loosen, and they can sometimes create a fistula to the surface, where the tissue overlaying the abscess breaks down, allowing it to drain out by itself. This can either be within the mouth or out through another surface, like the cheek. The abscesses can also erode into nearby structures, like the nasal sinuses, causing sinusitis, as well as the floor of the mouth or even into the neck. Diagnosing a dental abscess is usually done by feeling for areas of tenderness and fluctuance. And imaging studies like X-rays or a CT scan can be done to determine the exact location and size. Generally speaking, infections are treated with antibiotics, but in order for antibiotics to work, they need to first reach the bacteria, and that's usually done through the bloodstream. Since abscesses do not have blood vessels inside of them, the antibiotics can only diffuse into an abscess, and that's not very effective, especially when dealing with a large abscess. You could imagine it getting to the bacteria close to the edges, but there's no way it's getting to the bacteria in the middle. That's why the most important treatment for an abscess is incision and drainage. In other words, cutting it open and removing the pus. This is typically followed by frequent saltwater rinses, pain-relieving medications, and regular checkups. For a periapical abscess, a root canal treatment or extraction has to be performed on the offending tooth to get rid of the infection that cannot be reached by an incision and drainage or antibiotic treatment. Sometimes, antibiotics are used even after drainage to make sure that there are no additional bacteria lingering around. Alright, as a quick recap. Dental abscesses are a mix of immune cells, pathogens like bacteria like Viridans group Streptococcus, and dead tissue. Common types include periapical, periodontal, gingival, and pericoronal abscesses. Because there's no blood supply to the middle of an abscess to deliver antibiotics, it usually needs to be cut open so that the pus can drain out. For periapical abscesses, a root canal treatment or extraction has to be performed on the offending tooth.